Good morning, friends, and welcome to worship at Blythewood Road Baptist Church. This is Sunday, the 16th of August, and we're glad you can join us online. We have a couple of announcements to make. The first is that we are hoping, in God's will, to be able to resume worship in person in September, and the date we're thinking of is September the 13th. So if you haven't already, let the church office know about whether or not you feel you would be able to be here starting on the 13th. That will give us an idea just of the numbers to expect. We'll still have online worship for you to participate in, and then, as I say, hopefully be able to gather as well. So if you can let us know, it would help us with the numbers. And if you're not sure yet, well, just let us know that you're not sure, and that's perfectly fine. The other announcement that I have is that we will have an outdoor lemonade and cupcake social distance today in the church parking lot right behind us here from between 2 to 4. So please come to that if you're able. And we'll have lemonade, we'll have cupcakes, maybe some small sandwiches too. We'll be playing some music and just getting to be with one another. So we're looking forward to that. Now, one of the families we'll be missing today is the Barreto family. And for those who don't know, Bong has gone to Wisconsin to start his job in Madison, Wisconsin. And he left for Wisconsin on Friday. So we're missing Bong. We'll be missing you, Bong, and know that we'll be praying for you. And you're very much in our hearts. This morning, friends, we're continuing our summer-long series in the book of Job. And we're coming to a portion that we've awaited a long time for, which is God speaking, when God speaks to Job. So let's pray now as we prepare to worship and ask God to prepare our hearts that God will speak to us. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for this opportunity we have to praise you, to hear your word, and Lord, to listen to your voice. And we say, speak, O Lord, for your servant is listening. May this be the prayer this morning of all our hearts. And we ask that you would bless this day to us. And we think of our brother Bong as he's starting a new chapter in his life. All he has meant to this faith family, Lord, is wonderful. And we're thankful for him. And we ask that you would continue to bless and to keep our brother. And continue with us now and be close to us. In Jesus' name, we pray all of these things. Amen. Today's call to worship, friends, is as follows. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. And we're going to sing together. We're going to sing about who God is, immortal, invisible. We're going to sing about how good God is. And we are going to sing about how often words fail us. And God is indescribable, yet even then, still we praise. So let's sing together.
Thank you. all good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Well, from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you.
This morning's scripture is a selection from Job chapters 38 through to 41. So we're going to start with Job 38, verses 1 to 11. If you have your Bibles out, you can follow along. And these are the words of God to Job, my friends. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind. Who is it that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up your loins like a man. I will question you, and you shall declare to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? On what were its bases sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone when the morning stars sang together and all the heavenly beings shouted for joy? Or who shut in the sea with doors when it burst out from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and thick darkness its swaddling band? And prescribed bounds for it, and set bars and doors, and said, thus far shall you come, and no farther, and here shall your proud waves be stopped. The next passage I'm going to read is from chapter 39. I'm going to read verses 1 through 8. Still God talking. Do you know when the mountain goats give birth? Do you observe the calving of the deer? Can you number the months that they fulfill? And do you know the time when they give birth? When they crouch to give birth to their offspring and are delivered of their young. Their young ones become strong. They grow up in the open. They go forth and do not return to them. Who has let the wild ass go free? Who has loosed the bonds of the swift ass, to which I have given the steppe for its home, the salt land for its dwelling place? It scorns the tumult of the city. It does not hear the shouts of the driver. It ranges the mountains as its pasture, and it searches after every green thing. And now I'm going to read from chapter 40. And this is Job answering God, sort of in the middle of God talking. Then Job answered the Lord, see, I am of small account. What shall I answer you? I lay my hand on my mouth. I have spoken once, and I will not answer twice, but will proceed no further. And then finally, I'm going to read chapter 40, from verse 15 and then on into chapter 41. So this is God speaking again. Look at Behemoth, which I made just as I made you. It eats grass like an ox. Its strength is in its loins and its power in the muscles of its belly. It makes its tail stiff like a cedar. The sinews of its thighs are knit together. Its bones are tubes of bronze, its limbs like bars of iron. It is the first of the great acts of God. Only its maker can approach it with the sword. For the mountains yield food for it where all the wild animals play. Under the lotus plants it lies in the covert of the reeds and in the marsh. The lotus trees cover it for shade. The willows of the wadi surround it. Even if the river is turbulent, it is not frightened. It is confident though Jordan rushes against its mouth. Can one take it with hooks? Or pierce its nose with a snare? Can you draw out Leviathan with a fish hook, or press down its tongue with a cord? Can you put a rope in its nose, or pierce its jaw with a hook? Will it make many supplications to you? Will it speak soft words to you? Will it make a covenant with you to be taken as your servant forever? Will you play with it as with a bird, or will you put it on a leash for your girls? Will traders bargain over it? Will they divide it up among the merchants? Can you fill its skin with harpoons or its head with fishing spears? Lay hands on it. Think of the battle. You will not do it again. Any hope of capturing it will be disappointed. Were not even the gods overwhelmed at the sight of it? No one is so fierce as to dare to stir it up. Who can stand before it? Who can confront it and be safe? Under the whole heaven, who? And this, friends, is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God for it. Amen. So for a while now, I've thought that the book of Job would make a great play. It would make a great thing to produce on stage. And if you've ever seen or read Beckett's Waiting for Godot, you know that in this play, Godot never shows up. It's an absurdist kind of view that Beckett presents in this play. And the two main characters, Vladimir and Estragon, they just keep on waiting. There's no purpose to anything. Nothing matters. Conversely, We've been waiting for God to show up in the book of Job, and in the book of Job, God shows up. And the way we feel about God is in large part going to determine how we look at these chapters, how we look at God's words. And people through the years have said very many different things about God's words to Job. George Bernard Shaw said this. We're missing this year the Shaw Festival. George Bernard Shaw, he said this: if I complain that I am suffering unjustly, it is no answer to say, can you make a hippopotamus? And he's referring here to that talk about the behemoth that we read from chapter 40. Some people think that this is in reference to a hippopotamus. So Shaw says this. This passage really has been interpreted in as many ways as people see God. And we may come to this passage and find it a little disappointing. We might have been expecting answers to the questions that have been posed about suffering. Why do good people suffer? How do we reconcile the justice of God with suffering? In any case, though, we come to this passage that we've read, well, we read part of it this morning. We come to these chapters confessionally. That is to say, we come to these chapters bringing what we believe about God. There was a Norwegian theologian, and his name is Peter Wessel Zapfe. And he talks about God's appearance here, and he talks about what God says like this. And brace yourself, because it's not good. He says, Job finds himself confronted with a ruler of grotesque primitiveness, a cosmic cave dweller, a braggart and blusterer, almost agreeable in his total ignorance of spiritual culture. What is new for Job is not God's greatness in quantifiable terms, that he knew fully in advance. What is new is the qualitative baseness. And I say, ouch. And as I read that, I think, well, maybe this is why Peter Wessel Zapfe is really not very famous or known. And no disrespect to Brother Peter. I haven't read anything else that he's written. So if you're of a different view or know something about him and can enlighten me, I invite you to do that. But this is what some people have said about these chapters. There's this quote from Elie Wiesel. Elie Wiesel was a survivor of Buchenwald, and Auschwitz. He went on to become a writer, a professor of religious philosophy. And he said this: actually, God said nothing that Job could interpret as an answer or an explanation or a justification of his ordeals. God did not say, you sinned, you did no wrong, nor did he admit his own error. He dealt in generalities, offering nothing but vast simplifications. So the question for us then becomes, how do we answer this kind of thing? And how do we look at these chapters? And there are two things, friends, as we begin this morning that we can be sure of. And one is that what God says here is not going to be something which supports what we've been calling conventional wisdom, the wisdom that we've already seen, the so-called conventional wisdom that's been put forth by Job's three friends and then repeated by Elihu. The second thing that we can be sure of here is that we're going to have a place to stand. As followers of Christ, we can be sure that we're going to have a place to stand because the scripture has been given to us for a reason. And I believe that God has something to say to us. So we'll have a place to stand. The question for us as we come to the passage this morning is, where do we stand as we read God's words? And it really is the existential question of our lives. This is what we've been saying from the outset. What is the foundation upon which we stand? And so we've been asking questions like, why are the righteous pious? Do you still persist in your integrity? That was one of the questions that we heard. Do you still persist in your love and adoration and worship of God? And do you still persist in making God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit the very foundation of your life, no matter what is going on, circumstance-wise, good or bad? Or do you not? Is all of this meaningless? And by all of this, I don't necessarily mean all of Job or even all of this. I mean everything. Is all of it meaningless? Much like Beckett put out in his play. So that's the question. and what we believe is going to color how we see chapters 38 to 41 of Job's story. But we still need a place to stand. So let's ask for God's help, friends, as we look for a place to stand together this morning. Let's pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Amen. We've spoken from the beginning of July when we started this journey through Job. At the beginning of July, we've spoken week by week of the power of questions. Questions that can lead us into a deeper understanding of God, and questions that can lead us into a deeper understanding of ourselves and of the world. And this question has been sort of the underlying question that we've been looking at. You know, I've already said it, is God worthy of being our foundation? We've put it different ways. Is God worthy of our worship? Is God worthy of our adoration and love and attention? But really at heart, is God worthy of being our foundation every day, no matter what circumstances we're in? And as we come to these chapters where God speaks, I think that to expect God here to answer questions about why the innocent suffer, or where the justice is in innocent suffering, it's to do the text a disservice. I think that it's to do God a disservice too. It's not to mean that we don't have our questions. It's not to say that we don't have our doubts. And oftentimes we think of coming to church, we think of things like coming to church or reading the Bible or speaking with a religious professional. We think of it in terms of coming to these places with our questions in order to have our questions answered. But I want to say that equally and perhaps even more important or valid are the questions that are asked of us. And this is really a famous rabbinical technique. God here this morning is asking questions of Job. It's a famous rabbinical technique. We see that Jesus did it all the time. Jesus was famous for asking questions of people. In this way, the teacher does not so much give us the answers, but the teacher asks the correct questions. The teacher asks the questions which are going to enable us to come up with the answers. And what we have here in these chapters, 38 to 41, is we have God asking questions, and he's asking questions of Job. Now, I do not read these verses as God bragging or as God simply asking questions that he knows Job will find impossible to answer. I don't believe that God says, "Where were you when I was making the world?" I don't think he's saying this in order to imply, "Well, if you think you could have done a better job, then be my guest. Or if you think you could have even done that, then yeah, right." I'm thinking of, you know, something like you make a dinner and somebody is complaining about the dinner. I mean, I hope this doesn't actually happen. But say you made dinner and somebody is saying that, you know, something is overdone or so on. And we could say to them, "Well, where were you when I was chopping up the onions or boiling the potatoes or whatever?" This is not what God is doing here. I don't believe that when Jesus said to his followers, "Are you able to drink the cup that I'm going to drink?" I don't think that what Jesus was doing was bragging and saying, "Look, I'm the Son of God. I'm the only one who can do this. So get out of my way and let me do my thing." I don't believe this to be the case. I don't think Jesus was bragging, and I don't think that God is bragging here. I think that God is asking questions, and they're legitimate questions. Now, God is asking them, of course, ironically, but God is not without his literary talents. And he's asking them in order to bring Job, and in order to bring us, as we hear the questions and as the questions are posed to us, I think they're being posed to us so that we can come to a deeper understanding of God, of who God is and of who we are. And here are the three questions, and the three questions are what this sermon is entitled. If you're taking notes, you can make note of them. Who are you? Where were you? And are you able? So we'll come back to those in a little while. Who are you? Where were you? And are you able? And really, these questions form the foundation of our life. Who are you? Where were you? Are you able? The thing about this situation that Job finds himself in here is the same thing about the situation that we find ourselves in when we are in the midst of suffering. Oftentimes, when we are in the midst of suffering, no matter what kind of suffering we're in, we find ourselves at the limit of our own ability. We find ourselves unable to extricate ourselves from some sort of dire situation. We go from days of sunshine to days of something else. And oftentimes it's in those times that God speaks to us. God certainly speaks to us in silence. And we remember that God spoke to Elijah. God did not speak to Elijah in the wind, nor in the earthquake, nor in the fire. But God spoke to Elijah in the stillness. And sometimes that's where God speaks. But here we're hearing God speaking from the storm. Here God is speaking from the whirlwind. And this is how the imagery changes. At the end of chapter 37, Elihu's sort of finishing off his speech. And we looked at this last week. But when Elihu is finishing off, he speaks of light when it is bright in the skies. Many of us, if you're in Ontario, we've experienced many days of this. The light being bright in the skies, all kinds of sun. He speaks of out of the north coming splendor, and around God is awesome majesty. He speaks of earth being still because of the south wind, and he speaks of how no one can look on the light when it is bright in the skies, when the wind has passed and cleared them, and out of the north comes golden splendor, and around God is awesome majesty. It's lovely. And this is how Elihu is speaking at the end of his speech. He's talking about the majesty of God. He's talking about the sun and splendor and golden light. Sunny days, whether literal or figurative, that speak of the glory of God, of the majesty of God. Wonderful. The thing is, then comes the whirlwind. Then comes this voice of God, for which we've been waiting. And the thing about a whirlwind, when sunny days become a storm, when sunny days become a whirlwind, it tends to focus things. And we've been talking about this since the beginning of the summer too, getting to the essence of things. When we are confronted by the whirlwind, when we are confronted by our own finitude, our own mortality, it tends to take us to the essence of things, and a lot of extraneous kind of things get stripped away. I was in the dentist office recently, and I know I've been speaking a lot about the dentist, but you know, really it's one of the only things really I've had going on through these weeks. I was going to have a root canal done. And the dental assistant took me to a separate room, a separate area, And they did this sort of 3D scan of my mouth. And I had not seen this machine before. And I put my chin on the little thing. And they started it, and this thing went all around my head like this. And then we were finished. And when we came back down into the room where the orthodontist was, there was a computer screen just to my left here. And on the screen, I saw this picture. And I thought that this was my skull. I thought that this was the picture that had just been taken. And I had been thinking about Job 38 to 41 and God speaking to us and my own mortality and our mortality, because, you know, this is the kind of thing I do when I go to the dentist or otherwise. But I thought it was my own skull. And I said, wow, way to be that's quite a way to be confronted by one's own mortality, right in the dentist. Now, I asked the dentist, I have to say, I said to the orthodontist, is that my actual skull? It turned out it was just an icon. It was just some generic skull. But the point had been made. I want to tell a story that probably makes the point better. And it's a long story, but I think it's worthwhile. And it's from a U.S. philosopher. His name is Henry Bugbee. Henry Bugbee has a book called The Inward Mourning. And listen to the story he tells. It was in the summertime at a summer resort along the North Fork of the Trinity River in California. On a day like so many summer days, a bright sun streaming through the tops of pines, speaking of sunlight and sunny days. Most of the length and breadth of that long, smooth, flowing pool lay translucently exposed to the bouldered bottom. You can picture it. Children played on the sandy shores or splashed along the fringes of the pool. The air was of ambient fragrance of pines, reassuring warmth and stillness, refreshing coolness of moving water. The roar of the rapids below the pool might have been but a ground base of contentment, filling us all. So this kind of idyllic scene that Bugby is painting here. There came a cry for help, seconded with a cry of fright, and I turned toward the tail of the pool just in time to see a young man desperately, failingly clinging to a great log which had been chained as a boom across the lower end to raise the water level in the pool. No one could reach him in time. An enormous suction from under the log had firm hold of the greater part of his body and drew him under. He bobbed to the surface of the first great wave of the rapid below, but there was no swimming or gaining the bottom to stay what seemed an impending execution on the rocks, some 100 yards down. But it chanced that the river was abnormally high, and as it carried this helpless man doomward, it swept him just for a moment under the extremity of a willow which arched far out from the bank. With a wild clutch, the young man seized a gathering of the branches and held. Everything held. He had barely the strength and the breath to claw himself up the muddy slope onto firmament. I had run across the log and arrived on the opposite side below the willow, where he now paused, panting on all fours. Unable to rise, slowly he raised his head, and we looked into each other's eyes. I lifted out both hands and helped him to his feet. Not a word passed between us. As nearly as I can relive the matter, the compassion that I felt with this man gave way into awe and respect for what I witnessed in him. He seemed absolutely clean. In that steady gaze of his, I met reality point blank, filtered and distilled as the purity of the man. Meeting reality point blank, this young man had stared death in the face, and things got down to their essence. Getting to the essence of everything is what we've been talking about. And no words, no pass between them in this story, Bugby and the young man. Is it any wonder that Job tells God in chapter 40, verse 4, I lay my hand on my mouth? He has gone back to silence in the face of the whirlwind. And this is the thing about words. The river, you see, doesn't care about moral philosophy. The river doesn't care about the morality of its actions. The river has no time for moral philosophy or things like the trolley dilemma and discussions about such things. When you're swept up in the river, it is not the time for endless arguments and discussions about cause and effect and theodicy and how can a just God be righteous or why does this happen or not happen or us putting our own ideas about suffering and justice on God and our great wisdom. When you're caught up in the river, it's time for questions. Yes. But we find that the questions here, my friends, are being asked of us. These questions are asked of us, and we've laid them out already. Who are you? Where were you? And are you able? These questions are there to lead us into a deeper relationship with God. They're not to belittle, but they're rather to affirm. Who are you is the first one. Who is it? Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge is how God starts. Who are you? Who am I? These are the words that Moses asked, aren't they? When he met God by the burning bush. Who am I? It's the same question that the psalmist asked in a broader sense. The psalmist said, what is humanity that you are mindful of them? And this talk of creation in the passages we read, friends, points to the answer. Who am I? I'm a creation of the living God who made me in his image. That's who I am. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth, God says? Not in the sense of I didn't see you there, or it's not like you were helping me, or who do you think you are? But in a sense of, do we actually know the answer to this question? Where were we when God was laying the foundations of the earth? Where was I when God was laying the foundations of the earth? And do you know how Paul answers this question In his letter to the people of Ephesus, this is what Paul writes. He writes, "Chosen by God in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love, destined for adoption as his child through Jesus Christ, according to the pleasure of his goodwill, to the praise of his glorious grace." That's where I was, friends. That's Ephesians 1, 4-6. So God says, gird up your loins like a man or a woman or a child and pray to God that God will enable us to live into this identity. To be the man or woman or child that God created us to be, created and loved by a loving God. And let us sing praise to God just like the morning stars. God talks about the morning stars that sang together and the heavenly beings who shouted for joy. And what is this if not an invitation to us to join them? So we say, let's join them. We've already been doing that this morning. We're going to do it some more. Let's join those morning stars and the heavenly beings in praising our loving God, who is over all and through all and in all, and who both restrains and sustains. Listen to this verse where God is speaking about the sea. God says, who shut in the sea with doors? Listen to these images of birth and care. Who shut in the sea with doors when it burst out from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and thick darkness its swaddling band. God made it. God restrains it. God sustains it. How wonderful is that? You know, I like to say I have a healthy respect for the power of the sea. You've heard me say this before, and that may be odd considering I come from a long line of people who were on the sea and who built ships. And I don't even really have experience of the sea, but I have a healthy respect for it. There are things more powerful than we are, you see. But nothing is more powerful than God. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty. That's a song that we used to sing when I was young. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do, is what we sang as children. And it seems as people, as humans, we were made to recognize that there are powers beyond us. You know, when we're very young, we oftentimes think that we see our parents, don't we, as invincible. Until life sadly disabuses us of that notion. We have notions of care, we have notions of justice and rightness because we're made in God's image. At the same time, we're dust, and it doesn't do to place our own preconceived notions of such things on God. These words of God, my friends, are called to trust. It's a call to trust God who, as he reminds Job, looks after the mountain goats. And he looks after the deer as they have their baby deer. And he looks after the wild donkey even. And he gives it the step for a home. And he so clothes the lilies of the field. And he is aware even of the sparrow falling. And this is the God, my friends, in whom we are invited to trust, even when we don't know the answers. So are we willing to trust this creating and nurturing and sustaining God whose son talked about lilies and sparrows, whose eye is even on the sparrow, and who will make sure that injustice will not rule the day, who will ensure that the arc of history is indeed long and bends toward justice? Are we able? And that's our last question. Are you able? And this is our invitation, and it's the last question that we're going to talk about this morning. Are you able? Am I able to trust in God who doesn't provide easy answers and sometimes, you know, doesn't provide any answer? But here's the thing that God has provided, my friends. God has provided a willow branch for us to grasp onto. You know, a prophet once told of a shoot that would come from a stump, from the stump of Jesse. A shoot that would come from the stump of Jesse. And what that means, what the prophet was talking about, is that prophet was declaring this. The prophet was talking about a branch. But you see, it's not so much a branch as it is an arm with an open hand that's held out to us. And it's an open hand which we can grasp and which we can cling to and which will cling on to us and which will draw us up out of that torrent in which we're lost and which will bring us out of the torrent and up onto solid ground and give us a place to stand and give us a foundation. And of course, that branch that the prophet was talking about is Christ. A foundation who asks his followers. His followers will wonder about greatness and what greatness means. And he'll say to them, are you able to drink the cup? And he's not saying this to brag. And he's not saying this to belittle. He's actually laying out the choice that's before us. Are we able to drink that cup? Are you able? And this is our final question that we're going to look at this morning. Are you able to follow this Savior? And God grant that you're at home or wherever you're listening to this and you're nodding or you're saying yes or you're saying amen. God grant that that may be the case for us this morning. And maybe, you know, you might be saying this morning for the first time and you've never said it before and you've never said, yes, I want to grab onto that hand and I need saving and I want you, Jesus, to take me out of this torrent that I'm in. And I want to follow you. And if the Spirit is speaking to your heart to say yes to that invitation and to say, yes, I am able, and this is the Savior that I want to follow, then tell someone. Let me know. Let Pastor Abby know. Let someone who loves you know that you've decided to do that. To drink this cup, you see, is to recognize that while suffering can't be explained, it can't always be explained, that we are led, that we follow a Savior who brings life even from death. It's to recognize that the way of God, that the way to greatness is the way of self-giving love. So are we able to be led by such a Savior? And do we answer every day, no matter what our circumstance, yes, I am able, and this is the Savior that I want to follow, and let my life show that this is what I'm doing? So these were our questions. Who are you? I'm a beloved child of God. May God help us to recognize this and help us to live into the answer every day. Where were you? We were chosen by God from the foundations of the world to be holy and blameless, not in ourselves, but before him in love, and adopted as his children. And may God grant us and help us to accept our royal identity in Christ. And are you able? Are you able? God grant that each and every one of us gives the answer, yes, in love and gratitude to our loving and merciful and gracious God. May this be true for each and every one of us, friends. Amen. Amen. In our text this morning, friends, God spoke of the morning stars that sang together and the heavenly beings that shouted for joy. And part of what we do when we're following Christ is we join our voices with that praise and with those shouts. So we're going to sing again. The song is called Majesty. It's about the greatness of God and God's mercy and love for us and grace. And we need only come with empty hands and we're made alive. In his hands. In his hands we're given life. So let's sing together. Thank you.
We have heard God's word for us today. We have heard his invitation, and we have responded with our praise, and now we will respond with our prayers. Join me. Holy God, you are so good. Our minds cannot fathom your greatness, and we are truly in awe of who you are. Lord, as we come to you this morning, we are aware of our own inadequacies. We are aware of how we have failed you and not lived up to your standards. And God, we confess this before you, and we know that you offer your forgiveness. And we know that despite our inadequacies and our failures, God, you still call us your beloved children. God, we think of all the ways that you are working in our world, and we give you thanks. We think of the ways that you have kept us and held us together through these last months, and we give you thanks. And God, many of us are in a time of waiting this morning, whether waiting for a new season to start or waiting for decisions to be made or simply waiting. And God, we give that to you. We think of your promises that you tell us that as we wait, you are with us, that as we wait, you are still working and still acting. And God, we trust you. God, there are many ways in which we see suffering all around us. We lift up those to you in our congregation who are sick, who are struggling, those who are traveling, those who are lonely. And God, we ask that you would be near to them, that you would keep them safe, that you would surround them with people to encourage them and love them well. God, we think of those in our city, in our community, who are homeless and who are unsure of where they'll be living in the next few months. We think of the unrest in this very neighborhood, God, over shelter locations. And God, we pray that you would have your hand on that situation. God, we ask that you would touch people's hearts, that you would fill them with compassion. And Lord, that people in the city would be able to come together to find a solution that works for everyone. God, we think of people around the world who are struggling, who are still dealing with the effects of COVID-19. God, we ask that you would be with those who are working towards a vaccine and that that would happen safely and quickly. God, we think of countries where there is unrest right now because of protests for political reasons. God, may your church rise up in those places and be a light and bring words of peace. And God, as we look toward September, toward gathering together, we ask that you would give us wisdom as a church as we look at how that can happen safely. God, we thank you that you have allowed us to stay spiritually connected over these last few months. We thank you that your spirit binds us and is stronger than anything else, God. We love you, Lord, and we thank you for your love for us and for all the ways that you show that day by day, hour by hour, and moment by moment. We pray all these things by the power of your Holy Spirit and in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
We've been talking about the image of Jesus as a branch and as a hand that draws us up out of the water. And this last song that we're going to sing together speaks of our lighthouse, speaks of God as our lighthouse, guiding us safe to shore. So may this be our song, our praise, and our prayer as we go from this place of worship, friends. Let's sing together.
And in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea.
Father, be the light by which you walk. The compassion of the Son be the love by which you walk. And the presence of the Spirit be the power by which you walk. Amen.